The translation process is essentially a table lookup operation. Python provides a very natural object for dealing with these types of situations. This object is a dictionary. In this case, the key objects are strings, each consisting of three letters drawn from the four-letter alphabet. The value object is also a string, but a string consisting of just one character. Defining a dictionary can be somewhat tedious. In this case, we've already done this work for you. We've created a dictionary called table, where the keys are strings corresponding to codons or nucleotide triples, and the values are also strings which correspond to common one-letter symbols used for the different amino acids. Let's then open the file table.py. It's in my Python case studies translation dictionary. I'm going to open that, and I'll just mark the table, making sure to get the full table. I'll then go back to my editor here, and I'll copy-paste the dictionary in here. You'll see that the table dictionary appears indented. This is going to cause problems, so I want to make sure I will de-indent the dictionary, and now we're good to continue. Let's first make sure we know how to use this translation table. How would you look up the key that corresponds to CAA, or CCT, or GTA? I'm going to first just type table, and I might initially type CAA. But this is a problem, because the keys themselves are strings. That's why I need to provide a string as an input, and now I get the desired output. To look up CCT, I'm going to just change the string CCT, and the output is P. Let's then think about how to approach this problem. Here are the steps that I would take. First, I would check that the length of the sequence is actually divisible by 3. It should be, but sometimes things go wrong, so it's important to check this. Next, I would look up each three-letter string in our table and store the result somewhere. Finally, you keep doing this in a loop until you get to the end of the sequence. Let's write some informal pseudocode, step-by-step instructions on how to proceed. Let me first create some space here in my editor. The first task I would like to do is to check the length of the sequence. So we might say something like check that the sequence length is divisible by 3. If that's true, I can then loop over the sequence. For each iteration of the loop, I will need to extract a single codon. And finally, I need to look up the codon and store the result. Look up the codon and store the result. This is certainly not formal pseudocode, but these step-by-step instructions will hopefully help us as we start writing the actual code. Here we're going to check the length of the sequence. For a number to be divisible by 3, it must be that division by 3 yields a remainder of 0. Python, like many other languages, has a so-called modulo operator that yields the remainder from a division. If you haven't come across the modulo operator, this would be a good time to go online and search for it. Let's look at a couple of examples of the modulo operator. 7 divided by 3 yields 2.33. Let's do 6 divided by 3. That gives 2.0. In the first example, we would expect to have a remainder, but in the second, we would not. So if we go back to the example 7 divided by 3, and we replace division with modulo, the result is 1. 3 divides 7 twice, and 1 is left over. Let's look at the second example, 6 divided by 3. If we do 6 modulo 3, in this case, 3 divides 6 exactly twice, and nothing is left over. Let's look at the length of the sequence. And we can then ask if this is divisible by 3. In this case, the answer is no, and this is something that we'll come back to later. Let's start writing the code here. So we're now dealing with the first step in our pseudocode. We'd like to ask if the length of sequence modulo 3 is equal to 0. If that's the case, then we do have a valid sequence and we can proceed with the code. If you try running this, we can remove the first comment here. If you try running this, you'll see that it will not run. That's because if is a compound statement and Python expects something to be on the following line. We can use the pass statement here if we'd like to run the code. It doesn't do anything, which may sound odd, but it's helpful when Python syntax requires some statement, as is the case here. We can now try rerunning this, and the code runs. Let's then think about the loop. To loop over the sequence one character at a time, we could use the following structure. We can type for s in seq, and then we might just print s. We could build our code on one character at a time, but in this case, string slicing is probably a better alternative. Let's take our sequence and let's slice it. The starting point of the slice is 0 and the end point is 3. Remember, in this case, when you're slicing a string, the elements that will be located are those at positions 0, 1, and 2. In other words, Python stops before it hits the stop index. If I'd like to look at the next element, I want to start at 3 and end at 6. To look at the third element in the sequence, I would start at 6, end at 9, and so on. So to start a slice, I need to sequence 0, 3, 6, and so on for the starting locations. The endpoint is always going to be the starting point plus 3. This seems to call for a range object. For a range object, we specify the starting point first, say 0, the endpoint, let's say 11, and the step size. In this case, we've defined a range object, but if we want to print out the values, we need to first turn that into a list. So I'm constructing a range object, but to see the actual values in the range object, I will turn that into a list. We can now continue with our code. I then want to take my range object and move it to my code here. This replaces the pass statement. This is going to be a for loop. So we'll say for I in range starting from 0, we want to go to the end of the sequence. So the length of the sequence goes in here, and we'll go in steps of 3. This is the looping over the sequence part. So this line is now done. The next step is going to be extracting a single codon. I'm going to call that codon because that makes sense. I'll take my sequence, and the first starting point is going to be I, and I will slice from I to I plus 3. Again, this enables me to extract the codon. I can try running this code, and we see that the code runs. The next step is to look up the codon and store it. We can store the protein in a string and concatenate amino acids to it one at a time. Let's go back to our code. I will first initially need to create my protein. I'm just going to call that protein, and it's going to be an empty string. Once I've extracted my codon, I need to look it up. Remember, my table is called table. That's my translation table. I can look up my codon by typing table codon, and this is my new amino acid that has to be appended to the end of protein. Protein is a string, so we can concatenate the existing protein string to the new string, which is created by the table codon expression here, using the shorthand notation plus equals. So in this case, we're looking up each codon one at a time, and we are concatenating that to the existing protein string. I've now completed the last line, so I'm going to erase that, and I'm going to try running my code. The code runs, so at least we know that we don't have any syntax errors so far. It's helpful to turn our code to a function so that we can easily call it using different sequences. First, I need to start with the def statement. I'm going to call this function translate, because it translates the input sequence, a DNA sequence, into a sequence of amino acids. We need a colon at the end of the function definition. We then need to indent the code that I have here. Finally, we need a return statement that returns the protein to whoever called this function. And our function should be ready at this point. Let's then try running the definition of the function. And in this case, we're not getting any error messages, which is what we wanted. We can also try actually running the function. We've now defined it, but we haven't actually run it yet on any input data. Let's look at a couple of simple examples. I'd like to translate, say, ATA, and the result should be I, which is correct. Let me try one more example. I might want to translate AAA, and the answer should be K. So far, we're in good shape. While we're at it, let's add a docstring to our function. A docstring is a string literal that occurs as the first statement in a module, function, or class, or a method definition, and it becomes part of that object. You or somebody else can then use the help function to learn more about the function using the docstring. The docstring should summarize the behavior of the function and document its arguments, return values, possible side effects, and anything else that would be important for a user to know about the function. While the function is still fresh in our minds, let's try writing a short docstring. Here's an example of a docstring that I wrote earlier. Make sure to include your docstring inside the function definition. We can now rerun the definition of the function, which contains the docstring. We've just redefined it. If I now type help translate, you'll see that the docstring has become part of the function.